हेलो क्लास 10th, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद चैप्टर 2, द यूनियन एग्जीक्यूटिव. टुडेज टॉपिक इज द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया. वी विल डिस्कस द फॉलोइंग पॉइंट्स. सो द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ टुडेज टॉपिक इज हिज क्वालिफिकेशंस, द प्रोसीजर फॉर द इलेक्शन ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट, इनडायरेक्ट इलेक्शन फॉर द पोस्ट ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट, term of office. Now let's discuss some key terms. First term is republic. It means the state whose head is an elected person. Number 2, office of prophet. It means it is a position in government. Number 3, proclaimed offender. It means the title given to an accused who is not appearing in court even after executing non-bailable warrants against him or her. Number 4, electoral college. It means a body of electors chosen or appointed by a larger group. Number 5, proportional representation. It means an electoral system in which parties gain seats in proportion to the number of votes cast for them. The executive of the government of India consists of the president, the vice president, the prime minister and the council of ministers. The union executive consists of the president, the vice president and the council of ministers, with the prime minister as the head to aid and advise the president. The president of India. India is a republic. The head of the state in a republic is an elected person and he holds office for such a period as is defined and prescribed by the constitution of the state. The president of India is also an elected person. He holds office for 5 years. He can be re-elected after the expiry of his tenure, but he, as a convention means agreement laid down by our first president, the late Dr. Rajendra Prasad, does not seek elections to this high office for a third term. India is called a republic because a form of government in which representatives are entitled to act on behalf of the people whom they are represent. In republic, the head of the state is an elected person and he holds office for a prescribed period by the constitution of the state. In India, president is the head of the state and an elected person for 5 years, and he can be re-elected for next term after the expiry of his tenure. But an agreement was set up by our first president, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, that no candidate shall seek election of president for a third time in succession. His qualifications. To seek elections to the high office of the President of India, a candidate should possess the following qualifications. He should be a citizen of India. He should be of 35 years of age at the time of election. He must be qualified for elections as a member of the Lok Sabha, but shall not be a member. He should not hold any office of profit under the central or state government. If he holds, he should vacate such a post before seeking the election. It must be mentioned here that the governor of a state or a minister of a union or state or vice president of the union will not, however, be considered a person holding an office of profit. He should not be a proclaimed offender or a sentenced criminal under the law of the land. To seek elections to the high office of President of India, a candidate should be a citizen of India, not less than 35 years of age, and qualified for elections as a member of the Lok Sabha, but shall not be a member, and also not hold any office of profit under central, state or local government. And he should also not be a proclaimed offender. Our present president of India is Shri Ramnath Kovind. Here is his picture. Moreover, as the Presidential Election Act provides a prospective presidential candidate is required to get his nomination paper proposed by at least 50 electors and seconded by another 50 electors. The presidential candidate has also to deposit a security of ₹15,000 while filing his nomination papers, which stands forfeited if a candidate fails to get at least 1/6 of the total votes. The nomination of a candidate for elections to the office of the president must be subscribed by at least 50 electors or as proposers and 50 electors as seconders. Each candidate has to make a security deposit of ₹15,000 in Reserve Bank of India, which may be deprived if the candidate fails to get at least 1/6 of total votes. Now, fact file. Dr. Rajendra Prasad had the longest tenure as head of the state. He was President of India from 26 January 1950 to 13 May 1962, a period of 12 years. Now, the President can serve for a maximum of 10 years only, two terms. Dr. Rajendra Prasad had the longest term as the head of the state, a period of 12 years. He was President of India from 26 January 1950 to 13 May 1962. But as a convention laid down by our first president that no candidate shall seek election of president a third term. The procedure for the election of the president. The President of India is not directly elected by the people. He is elected indirectly by an electoral college, which consists of A. The elected members of the legislative assemblies of all the federating states. The elected members of the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. The election of the president is not direct and simple one. He or she is not directly elected by the citizens of India like other MPs and MLAs. The president shall be directly elected by the members of an electoral college consisting of the elected members of both houses of parliament, it means MP of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, the elected members of the legislative assemblies of the states and union territories, that is Delhi and Puducherry. Here we refer MLA of states and union territories. Now here, citizens of India vote for MP and MLA, and they are directly people's representatives, and it is these elected representatives who vote for the President of India. Value of the vote of each member of the Vidhan Sabha Legislative Assembly is determined by dividing the population of the state concerned by the total number of the elected members of the assembly. The quotient is so obtained is divided by 1000. Total population of the state divided by total number of elected members of the legislative assembly further divided by 1000. Now certain MPs and MLAs have certain number of votes. However, there is some calculations involved in determining the value of votes for every MLA and MP. So how to find out the value of votes of an MLA? Value of vote of an MLA is equal to total population of state divided by total MLAs of state further divided by 1000. Now we will take the example of Punjab in 2012. Value vote of an MLA in Punjab in 2012 is equal to population of state is 2,80,00,000 divided by total MLAs 117. The result is 2,39,316.24. Now it is further divided by 1000. The result is 239.31. Now the value of the vote of one MLA in Punjab is 239. Now we will calculate the टोटल वैल्यू ऑफ वोट्स ऑफ MLA इन पंजाब इज इक्वल टू 239 मल्टीप्लाई बाय 117, रिजल्ट इज 27,963. द वोटिंग पावर ऑफ एन इलेक्टेड मेंबर ऑफ द पार्लियामेंट इज वर्कड आउट एज पर द फॉर्मूला गिवन बिलो. टोटल वोटिंग पावर ऑफ ऑल द स्टेट्स डिवाइडेड बाय इलेक्टेड मेंबर्स ऑफ द पार्लियामेंट. By means of this arrangement, it has been ensured that the voting power of an MLA is proportionate to the population he represents. On the other hand, the voting power of all the elected members of the parliament is made equal to the voting power of all the elected members of the legislative assemblies in the country, so that the states should not have an upper hand in the election of the president. Similarly, total value of votes of MLAs of 29 states and 2 union territories is calculated and summed up. Now we will find out the value of votes of an MP. Value of votes of an MP is equal to total value of votes of an MLA in the country divided by total number of MPs in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Total value of votes all MLAs in the country for 2012 is equal to 5,49,474. Value of vote of an MP is equal to 5,49,474 divided by 543, that is the strength of Lok Sabha, plus 233, strength of Rajya Sabha. The result is 5,49,474 divided by 776. The result is 708. Now, the total value of votes of all MPs is equal to 708 multiplied by 776. The result is 5,49,408. Total votes to be casted for the presidential election is equal to 5,49,408 MPs plus 5,49,474 MLAs. The result is 10,98,882. The election of the president is held according to the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote system. According to this system, the voter may mark as many preferences 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so on the ballot paper as there are the candidates. After the casting of votes is over, first of all, the first preference votes are counted. If any candidate gets the absolute majority or more than 50% of the votes, he is declared elected and there is no need of counting the second preference votes. But in case no candidate is able to get the absolute majority, then the candidate who has secured the least votes is eliminated and his second preference votes are added to the other candidates. This process goes on and ultimately the candidate who gets the absolute majority is declared elected. Now the presidential election followed the system called the single transferable vote system. It is mentioned in Article 55(3). Now this system is different from the traditional ballot system. According to this system, each voter gives his or her preference for presidential candidate. Suppose there are 4 candidates, the voter will be given 4 preferences voters. Here are MPs and MLAs. Let's say candidate C is first preference, then candidate A is second preference, candidate D is third, and candidate B is fourth preference. Now here this is not enough. Now the person does not win here who gets the more votes or number one preference. The total number of valid votes decide how many votes will the candidate need in order to be winner. For example, candidate A gets, let's say, 4,000 votes. Candidate B gets 3,800, C gets 2,000 and D gets 1,000. Now, if you add all the votes, you will see 10,800 valid votes. So the winner required 10,800 divided by 2 plus 1 is equal to 5,401 votes to win. I just take 10,800 as an example. Now here we can see that candidate A has a maximum votes. In general elections, candidate A would have clearly win the election, but in presidential election that's not the case. Here D will eliminate it firstly. He has least number of votes. Now 1,000 voters choose candidate D as their first preference. Now all these 1,000 votes of candidate D will be transferred to A, B and C. Let's say in these 1,000 ballot papers, second preference are recorded as follows. Let's say 300 votes give candidate A as their second preference, B, 600 votes choose B as second preference, and finally 100 voters choose C as second preference. So you will see 300 plus 600 plus 100 is equal to 1000. It is the total votes of candidate D who has eliminated in the round 1. Now the new vote count will be like this. Candidate A has 4000 plus 300 is equal to 4300 votes. B candidate has 3800 plus 600 is equal to 4400 votes. C has 2000 plus 100 is equal to 2100 votes. Candidate B is leading now. Now in the second round, C candidate will be eliminated because he has least votes. Now the process will again repeat it. Now the 2100 votes of candidate C will be transferred to candidate A and B. Here we will choose third preference. 1000 voters choose A as a third preference. 1100 voters choose B as a third preference. The new vote count will be A is equal to A candidate 4300 plus 1000 is equal to 5300 votes. B candidate 4400 plus 1100 is equal to 5500 votes. Now clearly we can see the candidate B has crossed the threshold mark of 5401 votes. It is clearly that candidate B is the preferred and supported by large number of voters. So B is elected as a president. In case of any dispute over the election of the president, the 29th Constitution Amendment Act 1975 and the 44th Constitution Amendment Act 1978 lay down that such a dispute shall be decided by the Supreme Court of India. In case of any dispute regarding the election of the president, then the dispute shall be decided by the Supreme Court because it has original power regarding this. Indirect election for the post of the president. If the president was to be elected directly by the people, he could become a rival center of power to the Council of Ministers. This would be against the parliamentary system with ministerial responsibility. So children, as we have parliamentary form of government by which we choose our prime minister, which is directly done by the people of our country by voting. So we already have a center of power. Now if we choose or elect the president also by voting of people, then we would create two center of power, which will be a conflict of power at center. This electoral process ensures that the president represents the voice of the states as well as that of the union. As both members of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha vote for the election of president, so in this way both state and union take part in this electoral process. So this process ensures participation at both levels, state and union. An indirect election is suitable for the post of such dignity because it would be free of corruption and other malpractices. We all know that in our election a lot of corruption and malpractices are involved. So by the kind of indirect election we maintain the dignity and respect of such high post like president. It is a unique way of electing the head of the country without physically involving the entire population. It is indeed a unique way of electing head of the state as entire population of the country is involved indirectly where people vote through their elected representatives, that is MLAs and MPs of both houses. If there are two general elections, one for the members of the parliament and the prime minister and another one for the president, it would lead to tremendous expenditure, loss of resources, money, time and energy. We all know that process of conducting elections is very expensive, tedious and lot of resources are required for it. So by following indirect elections of the president, lot of money, time, energy is saved. Now, here is a list of presidents of India. You can see till now there are 14 presidents of India. Term of office. The president of India is normally elected for 5 years. His term of office can in no case be extended. His office can fall vacant under the following conditions. The term of the president is 5 years. His office can fall vacant under the following conditions. Number 1. Death. In case of death of the president, his office falls vacant. The vice president immediately takes over as the president. Elections for the new president must be held within 6 months of the date on which the president takes over as the acting president. In case of death of the president, the vice president immediately takes over the charge and the election for the new president must be held within 6 months. Resignation. The president may resign before the expiry of his full term by writing a letter addressed to the vice president of India, who will communicate this decision immediately to the Speaker of the Lok Sabha. A new president must be elected within 6 months. Till then, the Vice President acts as the President. The President can also resign from his post by writing a letter to Vice President of India, who will discuss this decision with the Speaker of the Lok Sabha. Till that time, Vice President acts as the President. The new President must be elected within 6 months. Now here is a fact file. Dr. Zakir Hussain from 1967 to 69 and Mr. Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed 1974 to 1977 are the two presidents of India who died while in office without completing their terms. Dr. Zakir Hussain and Mr. Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed were the two presidents of India who died while in office without completing their terms. Process of impeachment removal. If a president begins to act against the provisions of the constitution or is found guilty of misusing his status and position or found involved in corruption, he may be impeached out of office. If the president is found guilty or misusing his position, he may be removed from his office. The process starts with the charges being framed by either House of the Parliament in the form of a resolution passed by a two-thirds majority of the total membership of the House. The process may start in either of the two Houses of the Parliament. The House initiates the process by levelling the charges against the President by a two-thirds majority of the total membership of House. A 14-day notice signed by at least 1/4 of the total number of members has to be given. The charges are contained in a notice that has to be signed by at least 1/4 of the total members of that house. The notice is sent up to the president and 14 days later it is taken up for consideration. The other house investigates the charges leveled against the president. The other house investigates the charges that have been made. If the charges are upheld by a two-thirds majority of the total membership of the other house also, the president is impeached and removed from office immediately. If the second house also approves the charges made by special majority, again the president stands impeached and is deemed to have vacated their office immediately. The president has the right to appear in his own defense or to present this case before the investigating office. During this process, the president has the right to defend oneself through an authorized counsel. The president is also entitled to accommodation. Entitled means grant, accommodation means housing, in the Rashtrapati Bhavan free of cost. Besides, he gets such facilities and allowances as may be decided by the parliament from time to time. At present, he draws a salary of rupees 5 lakh per month plus other allowances. Many facilities have been given to the President of India, like housing is also sanctioned to the President in Rashtrapati Bhavan free of cost. He also gets allowances decided by the Parliament from time to time. At present, the salary of the President is rupees 5 lakh per month plus other allowances. Now here I want to add one more thing, oath of the President. The oath of the president is administered by the Chief Justice of India and in his absence by the most senior judge of the Supreme Court. Thank you.